Hello, Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas, and welcome back to our afternoon session. Listen, we're glad you're here. You know, I can tell you from experience, a lot of love, time, and work has went into making this virtual convention amazing. And it is the prayer of the laborers that you are well pleased. We are live streaming via our convention website and multiple social media streams. And so if you're viewing via Facebook or YouTube, make sure to send us some of your comments, some of your aha moments. We want to see how this is really resonating with you. And so earlier you heard from our convention, Congress of Christian Education, right? Now we're moving into our Women's Auxiliary School of Mission workshop. You know, when I was a young girl, I was told that when women unite, we can change the world overnight. And that's one of the reasons why I absolutely love sisterhood. So I'm not surprised that this School of Mission workshop will focus on unity, togetherness, and breaking barriers. And with that being said, again, grab your pen, grab your paper, and let's hear from the mighty women of God, what thus says the Lord.
Thanking and praising the Lord for the privilege of greeting you today to President Holder, President Kirkendall, Dr. and Dr. Love, and all of you, my father's children. Good evening and welcome to the School of Mission for the Women's Department of the Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas. We are so excited that you joined us today. Our theme is exceptional strength in togetherness, breaking barriers, working together in unity. I am Sharon Davis Brown, your first vice president. We will open with the invocation by Sister Betty Norwood, Missionary Department fourth vice president, after which Sister Angela Thomas will lead us in our memorial period.
Let us go to God in prayer. Our most gracious and honorable Heavenly Father, we do come boldly before your throne of grace and mercy. Lord, we thank you for your loving kindness. We thank you for your tender mercies. Heavenly Father, we just continue to lift up this convention and all who are here. Oh God, all those who are listening virtually. Oh God, bless the many who stand in the need, those who are sick among us, the bereaved families. And Lord, continue to bless this convention as we share the good news of your salvation, as we share, oh God, your loving kindness, that those who are lost may come to know you and depart of their sins. Bless each and every one, oh God. We want to thank you for your loving kindness. We want to thank you, oh God, that you are patient with us and that Heavenly Father, you are our strength and our very present help in the time of need. For these and all blessings we ask in your Son, Jesus' name is my prayer. Amen.
Your life was a blessing, your memory a treasure. You are loved beyond words, missed beyond measures. In memory, Willa Fant, Deacon William D. Pugh, Deacon Clarence P. Knoll, Deacon Adrian Count Sr., Mother Ozelle Kirkendall, Reverend Dr. Lemuel Wynn, Crystal Mitchell Hopkins, Charles Robinson Sr., Alcyon Amber, Teresia Counts, Deacon Ivanhoe Love Sr., First Lady Wilma Backus, Dolores Marie Davis Lamb, Deacon Morris Brown, Dr. A.J. Jones, Antoinette L. Holder, Deacon Clyde Collins, Reverend Claude Webbs, Jeanette Turner, Cynthia Lewis Barnes, Ruth L. Marlin Carter, Reginald Jordan Watkins, Christine McCullough, Sandra Victor, Deacon Henry Alston, Antoinette Evans, Deacon Woodrow Wilson, Rosemary Weisenberger, Deacon Joseph Walter Johnson, Reverend Dr. Harrison Fields, Mary Collins, Ruth A. Neals, David Jorna Berry. What a blessing to know that you are closed, you've closed your eyes on earth, but you've opened them in heaven. We remember you today.
All these men and women have left a powerful legacy of faith and love. We thank God for them. We will now introduce our presenters for this session. First is Sister Carol Hegwood. Sister Hegwood is a member of the Guiding Star Baptist Church, where Reverend David Lee is pastor. She is married to Reverend Ernest Hegwood and is the mother of four wonderful children. She has lived a life of missions beginning during her youth when she served on the foreign mission field with her parents, the late Reverend Benjamin and Sister Bercy Stevens. She has worked tirelessly in the youth ministries of her district and the state. She is a talented musician who loves the ministry of music. She is past Call Valley District Missionary President and past Youth Director of the Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas. She is a woman of God who does not cease to rightly divide the word of truth. She will speak to us on the topic, working together in unity. Dr. Janice Emerson Love is the First Lady of the Second Baptist Church of Olathe, Kansas. She has been married to her pastor husband, Dr. Bobby Love, for 18 years. She's a mother, mentor, friend, and personal development coach. Dr. Janice specializes in guiding pastors' wives and other Christian women towards more fulfilling lives. Besides being the founder of Pearls Perfected and Pearls Perfected Institute for Christian Women, she is a best-selling author, offers group and individual coaching and counseling, and is a motivational speaker. To date, she has written 3 books, and her First Lady blog is nationally known among Christian women throughout the country and internationally. Consistently open about her own life, she encourages others to understand the joys and unique wonders of life and love alongside a husband with vision. She will speak to us on the theme, Exceptional Strength in Togetherness. Before Sister Hegwood comes, we will have music by that amazing songbird of Kansas, Sister Wanda Adams of the New Fellowship Baptist Church. Sister Adams will come back to share with us after Dr. Love has shared.
His son, they call him Jesus. He came to love, oh, yeah. Heal and forgive. Tomorrow. Spirit, the living dust become believed. And then one day I'm going across the river. No war with pain. And then as death, oh yeah, 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 give away to victory.
Exceptional strength and gentleness, breaking barriers, working together in unity. Ephesians 4, 3 through 6, 11 through 13, and verse 16. School of Missions theme this segment, Working Together in Unity, and my subtitle, When All God's Children Get Together. Giving honor to God, acknowledging State Women's Auxiliary President, Sister Frankie Kirkendall, First Vice President, Sister Sharon Davis Brown, State Convention President, Dr. T. Lamont Holder, KBD Moderator, Dr. Desmond Lamb, my Pastor Reverend David Lee, other national, state, district, and local officers, convention delegates, association and local memberships, Christian friends, first-time new friends, and even our enemies, good evening. I bring you greetings from the great district of Call Valley. I've been asked to address the topic, Working Together in Unity, the scripture reference, Galatians 3, 26 through 28. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. For all of you who were baptized into Christ have clothed yourselves with Christ. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. This is not the first time we have discussed unity in the body of Christ. In fact, we have used varying names to get folks to come together. Anyone remember synergy? The positive combined effect of working together. Harmony? Working on one accord. We even made up a word, provolution, taking the best from the past and moving into the future. What I am afraid of today is that we still don't get it. So as my dad used to say, I can talk and talk till my tongue falls out, but you don't hear me, so I guess I'll have to say it again. Unity is the state of being united, joined as a whole, the opposite of being divided. We can only accomplish so much on our own.
But together, we can create a movement that brings tangible change and creates a future of hope. COVID-19 has taught us some things this year. COVID has a multiplication factor that Jesus taught in the Bible. In Acts 1 and 8, Christ said, believers will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on them. And we will be witnesses in Jerusalem at home, in all Judea as you travel, in Samaria in some area, and to the ends of the earth. Now, if COVID-19 could use two sick people to infect 8.32 million people in the United States, how much more effective we as a united church body endowed with the Holy Ghost should be in spreading the gospel. We should be getting multiple things done. Today is a new day. Technology is now available to extend your reach, but we must work together. There should be no more divisions. Christ transcends all differences, denominations, race, social status, gender, ancestry. We are all children of God through faith. We are all one in Christ Jesus. Do you know the value of the privilege of being united in Christ? The full rights to be called a child of God and enjoy equal entitlement to the spiritual blessings of righteousness? We have been bought with a great price, the blood of Jesus. John 1, 12 through 13 says, yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The body of Christ is a family. We must conduct ourselves in a way that that others can see how much family means to us. I have always felt a bit awkward about race discussions. I learned early in rural Nicodemus that I was colored. Later, a family discussion helped me define those colors as Black, American Indian, and Irish descent. Bet you didn't see that coming, huh? That's not all. While staying in Africa, I was advised that I was mixed, which meant that my color was too fair and my hair too straight. Imagine that. And so you can see my dilemma. I didn't really fit in anywhere, so I was told. I have also noted in my lifetime that I have a similar dilemma at worship, for invariably that very label has sometimes failed me when friends, family, or guests of other cultures or hues are invited to attend service. You see, I am a product of the Black church, and those roots are very important. But along with roots, we also require nurture, nutrients, and cultivation to help us develop, thrive, and mature properly into strong and healthy Christians. We can find all of these things in the Word of God. What kind of cultivating are you doing? As we mature, old ways of thinking should lead us to make some changes to include everyone and exclude no one. Romans 12 and 2 says, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. This is a new day, a day when all God's children get together. As such, the old Black church vernacular we used in the past has now become misspeak. Without realizing it, unconscious bias has crept into our midst, perpetuating an environment of style and culture over relevance. As such, we often place emphasis on things that have nothing to do with God and more to do with tradition. While some traditions are good, this particular mode is no longer effective for building unity. The book of Nehemiah shows us great lessons of working together effectively. In chapter 3, you will find it illustrates the value of unity, teamwork, and encouragement. Number 1, burdens are lighter when we share the work. Work goes faster when everyone works together. Distractions paralyze the work. That means there is no progress. So focus. Each person's work is important. Consider the church as one large jigsaw puzzle, and each of us as the pieces that make up the big picture. Only God knows what that picture is going to look like, but each of us must fill our space for the designer plan to be complete. Based on these lessons highlighted from Nehemiah, there are some questions we must all consider. If 90% of the work done in the church is done by only 10% of the people in the church, how much more could we accomplish with 100% of the church working for the cause of Christ and the glory of God? Ask yourself, am I a burden to the work God is trying to do around me, or am I making the burden lighter? If a study was done at my church, would I be counted in the 10% that does most of the work, or in the 90% that only accounts for 10%? Which group would I like to be remembered as being a part of? Am I acting like grease in the squeaky wheel that speeds up progress, or glue in the gears that slows the work down? How can I help the work of the church and do what needs to be done? What is my place in the church? Am I where I need to be? If we want to ensure that we inspire unity, each of us needs to start operating according to what Jesus taught. Start by talking to and building relationships with all cultures. Empower all social classes wherever you have opportunity. Work together in unity to build a community of faith that is warm and inclusive. Most of all, pass the good news on so that all God's children can get together and have a good time. How do you achieve unity? Instill a strong belief in family working together. When our leaders avoid finger pointing and blaming, and each of us learns to share in both success and failure, we will achieve unity. When we select the right people, individuals who share core values and have a common vision, when we consistently communicate the vision and mission of our organization, when we become loyal to the vision and the mission, and not just to the leader, unity will show up. Create an atmosphere of working through adversity. Expect conflict, but aim for that peace that will let brotherly love continue. I was reading a book on business success. Summarizing, it said, good leaders display window and mirror maturity. When things go well, good leaders point out the window and give credit to everyone else for a job well done. When things go wrong, they look at themselves in the mirror and take full responsibility. Be transparent and let folks know what is going on. We cannot live in a bubble forever. Communication is key. Most of all, we must have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us for unity to come. We must be united and possess the same grace, faith, love, and hope. Our aim ought to be about building up the body of Christ, all to the glory of God. Be kind to one another, love one another, pray for one another, forgive one another. Working together in unity is like walking together. You have to get close. You have to learn something about the one you are walking and working with. Work and walk in the Spirit. Discover who God really is and stick together. When all God's children get together, what a time. Be encouraged.
Greetings I bring to you from Independent Missionary Baptist Church, where my pastor, Reverend Dr. James F. Lambert. I greet you with the grace and the peace of God, who loves us as father and mother in Jesus Christ, who alone is our resurrected, our risen, our reigning, and our returning Redeemer. I like to read a poem by Irene Zimmerman titled The Broken Walls of Galatians 3 and 28, and it reads, in Bethlehem, a baby's cry shatters barriers. Women, men, and every creed, culture, and race gaze across the rubbled walls in wonder, finding every face luminous with godliness. The baby referenced in Irene Zimmerman's poem, The Broken Walls of Galatians 3 and 38, is our sweet Savior, Jesus the Christ. And I'm here in this moment to discuss breaking barriers as it pertains to a letter Paul has written to the Galatians in Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, where it reads, "For ye are all children of God by faith in Christ Jesus. For as many of you as have been baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither bond nor free. There is neither male nor female. For ye are all one in Christ Jesus." The remnants of these broken walls Zimmerman mentioned are still with us. Sometimes the pieces are so big and wide that it seems as if the baby had not been born at all. George Floyd was murdered by Officer Derek Chauvin when he placed his knee on his neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds while handcuffed on the ground. 5-year-old Cannon Hennett was murdered by Darius Sessoms while playing in his yard with his family. In an era when the entire U.S. workforce is becoming more educated, U.S. colleges are still failing to help Black students graduate. The Department of Education tracks incoming college freshmen classes to determine many students graduate within 6 years. White Hispanics and Asians have all seen their college completion rates rise within 1996 and since 1996. Blacks have not. There are still places in the world where girl babies are thrown away and people are denied what we believe to be basic human rights because they are female. The remnant, large and small, of all walls are still with us. It is true that Christ has shattered the barriers, but Galatians 3 and 28 calls us who have been baptized into Christ to something more than just gazing across the rubble. I'm talking about breaking barriers. The baptismal perspective is a bit more intimate. We are all wrapped in Christ and so drawn together into oneness. The oneness that doesn't take away the differences, but it means a new way of seeing and behaving. Religious and ethnic, socioeconomics, and gender differences in our day might not take those same labels of Jew and Greek and slave and free and male and female. We may need to translate the new categories like Korean and African American, Hispanic and Anglo, rich and poor, gay and straight, educated and uneducated, high church and low church, young and old, and the list goes on. The differences, whatever we call them, can still be divisive, and not just in the world, but also in the church. Amen. Hal David and Burt Bacharach composed the song, "What the World Needs Now is Love, Sweet Love." And the chorus of the song says, "What the world needs now is love, sweet love. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. What the world needs now is love, sweet love, not just for some, but for everyone. As a body of believers, we have that love. That love is in Christ Jesus." Paul tells us in the book of Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 28, this startling truth: Jesus Christ is the answer to all barriers, be it prejudice, bitterness, hatred, oppression, any inequalities of earth. Jesus is the answer. One may ask, how can Jesus solve the division among men? Note the phenomenal statement, ye are all one in Christ Jesus. Tell yourself or someone else, we are all one in Christ Jesus. One may ask, what is there about Jesus Christ that makes us one? I would answer the question with the following. First, every believer stands on an equal footing before Jesus Christ, the footing of faith. No person is accepted at any other reason than faith. All persons who come to Jesus Christ come because they are ever so short of Christ, because they are ever so different from Christ, and because they are ever so imperfect. Yet Jesus Christ accepts them. Jesus reaches out and embraces all believers, despite their beginning so much less and so different from him. Therefore, when we look at another believer and they differ from us, we do just what Jesus Christ did for us. We love, we accept, we embrace them. Differences do not matter. Let me say that again. We ought to love, we ought to accept, we ought to embrace them, because differences do not matter. All that matters is love, acceptance, and brother and sisterhood in Christ. Therefore, when we look at another believer, we see them in Christ. We do not see the believer, but we see Christ covering the believer. We pay no attention to their color, their nationality, their sex, their social status, or any other differences. Differences just do not matter. All that matters is that we all grow into the image of Christ. Love, accept, and because more and more the brothers and sisters of God embrace one another. If for some reason you are doubting what I am saying, look for yourself in Romans 10 and 12. It reads, for there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. Same book, different chapter. Go to Romans 12 and 5 and you'll find, so we being many are one body in Christ and every one members one of another. And last but not least, 1 John 1 and 7 tells us, but if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanseth us from all sin. All who have trusted in Christ as Savior are equal in the eyes of our Heavenly Father. Saved by grace through faith in God and God's only begotten Son. The only way to truly break barriers is in Christ Jesus. Tasha Cobb says, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. What chains are binding you today? Chains of racism, mental breakdown, chains of envy, chains of resentment, chains of hatred, chains of poverty, homosexuality, sexism. What chains? I dare you right now today to say, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Thank you.
Greetings to the Women's Auxiliary School of Mission of the Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas. I would also like to acknowledge our Women's Auxiliary President, Sister Frankie Kirkendall, Vice President, Coordinator, and Facilitator, Sister Sharon Davis Brown, everybody who is in attendance at this wonderful conference, and I bring you greetings from Second Baptist Church of Olathe, where I, Dr. Janice Love, serve as the First Lady and am married to Pastor Bobby L. Love, Sr. I am so thankful for this opportunity, and thank you so much for this invite. Thank you for the wonderful introduction as well. And I already know that the speakers that have gone before me have paved the way. Sister Carol Hedgewood talked about working together in unity. Minister Courtney Austin has talked about breaking barriers, and I know both presentations were wonderful. So my goal is simply to try to tie all this together by simply having a conversation with you. We are going to talk today about exceptional strength in togetherness. And this is coming from Ephesians 4, 4 through 6, 11 through 13, and then finally verse 16. Again, summing it all up, let's quickly take a look at Ephesians 4 and 16 from the New Living Translation. It says, "He makes the whole body fit perfectly together. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts to grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love." Now, I had to come up with a subtopic to already go with this wonderful topic that you have given us, exceptional strength in togetherness. I would simply give it something a little snazzy, like it's all about the bass. Now, some of you have heard a song called "It's All About That Bass," and it has nothing whatsoever, trust me, to do with God, religion, or anything. But as we look at this scripture today, this is really all about the bass, meaning B-A-S-E, not B-A-S-S. It's all about the bass. So when you think about a bass, the first thing you probably will think about is a foundation. Base is another word for foundation. And when you think about what a foundation is, we typically will think about wanting a solid foundation, right? We all want to stand on a solid foundation. If you were building a house, the foundation is that load-bearing part of the building that is typically below the ground level. But if it is not solid, the whole house can come tumbling down. So when we think about the base of the church being Jesus Christ, if the base is not intact, if our beliefs are not intact, then the whole thing can come tumbling down, right? If you also think about the base as the basis or the groundwork of anything that you do, again, we typically will seek a strong foundation or a strong base. So what I want you to get out of this today are just three simple little points. The first point is we all have the same base. That's number one. And this is going to carry out through my entire conversation with you. And then number two, the base makes the assignments. And then finally, number three, the base equips us for exceptional results or that exceptional strength that we're talking about. Now let's talk about us all having the same base. We all, in the church, we all have the same base. We all love the same God. We all have the same beliefs. It talks about one Lord. one faith, one baptism. We all believe the same thing. We believe the gospel of Jesus Christ. We believe that he died for our sins and that he alone saves us. That alone is the foundation on which we all stand. So when we all have that same base, we should see things moving in the same direction, right? We should all be traveling in that same direction. We should be able to stay together both inwardly and outwardly. So let me just read Ephesians 4, 4 through 6. And it says, for there is one body and one spirit, just as you have been called to one glorious hope. And see how many times it says one? One is one, right? You can't add anything to it and get one, another one, right? One is always one. So there is one Lord, one faith, and one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and living through all. So if we all have that same base, right, then you, perhaps in your family, maybe with your children, you all, they have the same parents, right? But sometimes you wonder if one is got something different than everybody else, because they just don't seem to be going in the same direction. So think about that in the church. If we all believe in the same Lord, if we all believe the same faith, and we all have been baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that means we all should be one, right? We all have the same base. Continue to keep that in mind as we continue to go through this conversation. Now, when we think about the next part of this, the base is the one that makes the assignments. We all know who the giver of the gifts is. And oftentimes we may spend our time focusing on the differences rather than thinking about how all those differences work together in order for us to complete our assignment, right? Differences enhance. Differences shouldn't drive us apart. Differences should enhance us. Now, just because we don't all look the same, we don't all speak the same, or because we don't act the same, does not mean that we cannot work together and actually flourish in those differences. The base is the one that makes the assignments. So when you look at Ephesians 4, 11 through 12, it says, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church: apostles, prophets, evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Again, they don't all have the same assignment, but it takes everybody working together in order for us to move to that next point, which is the base equips us for exceptional results. Now, what is the base training us to do? Ephesians 4 and 12 says, their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and to build up the church and the body of Christ. So when we have these assignments, we have an overall goal or an overall mission that God has given us, that we are to be training up skilled servant workers, equipping them, giving them everything they need. When you equip someone, that means there's nothing left out. It means that you have given them everything they need to get it done. So God has given us everything that we need to get it done, which means we should have those exceptional results. So what are those exceptional results? Meaning the parts fit perfectly together. Have you ever done a puzzle and you have a piece that you just can't seem to find anywhere, but by the time you put it all together and all the parts come together, everything fits perfectly. But if you try to put a part in the wrong space, it's not going to work. So having exceptional results means that the parts fit perfectly together. There's some growth that's going on. If there's not growth going on, that means something is not happening so that the workers are equipped. Maturity should be happening. We should be growing in grace, right? Love should be happening. As I read verse 16, it talked about growing together all in the same direction in love, in peace. And that gives us that exceptional strength. Now, when we think about strength, Strength is the capacity of an object or substance to withstand great force or pressure. Talking about ministering in unprecedented times, if we did not have that exceptional strength, we wouldn't have been able to withstand the great force or the pressure that was brought on by COVID-19. So again, those exceptional results mean that the parts are fitting together. There's growth, there's maturity, there's love, there's peace, and again, there is strength. Now, when we think about exceptional strength, right? Exceptional is something above the norm. It's above that commonplace or that mediocre. Who wants to be mediocre? Who wants to be just familiar or regular or ordinary or conventional? Who wants to be commonplace? Exceptional strength does not mean commonplace or mediocre. Exceptional strength means that it is unusual or it's not typical. It's better than expected. It's notable. It's noteworthy. It's phenomenal. It's rare. It's remarkable. It is unheard of. And so that's what we're talking about today, that this base gives us when we are doing what we're supposed to be doing and being in the role that we're supposed to be in, we will have that exceptional strength. Again, that unusual, that not typical, that better than expected, exceedingly abundantly, right? Notable, noteworthy, phenomenal, rare, remarkable, and unheard of. Exceptional strength allows us to be united like we are one person, to help the whole body to grow well, not just half the body, the whole body to grow well. And then each part is joined with the other parts that the whole body becomes stronger. You know, when you're working out, you just don't work out your arms and then forget about your tummies, right? Or forget about your legs. You'll become disproportionate if you work out one part of your body more than the other. But as each part does its proper work, we love each other more and more. So I have an example of where I have seen this exceptional work in process. Now, when I was coming up, I'm going to tell you that I was a cheerleader, right? I either was cheerleading, dancing, or I was baton twirling, right? I wasn't athletic, y'all. I was just not athletic, but I found my place usually with cheerleading, right? So when I had my own daughter, I was like, I hope she becomes a cheerleader, right? You all understand cheerleading, but cheerleading is nothing like it used to be when I was coming up, okay? We just got out there, yelled, jumped around, and then it was over. So when my daughter decided to be a cheerleader, I was really excited about that because she got a chance, well, she was actually going to live out some of my dreams to be a cheerleader, right? And be a good one at that. So, but she ended up getting involved in competitive cheer. And if you've ever watched any of those movies that have something to do with competitive cheer, you know that it is not what I did as a cheerleader. Now, if any of you know my daughter, when she was in the seventh grade or so, which is when she first got involved in competitive cheer, she's a little bitty thing, right? She barely, right now, at the age of 25, she barely weighs 95 pounds, right? She's 4'11", hadn't made 5 foot yet. And so she's a little person. So when in competitive cheer, there are typically three positions that you can have. There is a flyer. And that's usually the one everybody wants because the flyer gets to be the star of the show. There's a spotter. A spotter is the person that makes sure everything is going together in conjunction and making sure that nobody gets hurt. The spotter can see, can stand back from a distance and make sure that everything's in sync and that they can catch somebody if they fall. Or they are the ones that's calling the shots because they can see from a different perspective. All right. And then there is the base. All right. So again, because my daughter was so small, and when I looked around at the other cheerleaders, I assumed that she would be a flyer because I thought the flyer had to be the smallest person on the team. But when she came home and told me that she was actually going to be a base, it confused me because I didn't know anything about what it took to be a base. So what I found out is that to be a base is not necessarily about your size. It's all about your skill level and your abilities. That's what's important. And it was also about your ability to be trusted. So others have to trust you if you're going to be a base, because you have to have that strong foundation. Others have to trust you to hold them up. Others have to trust that you have that strength and that determination to help others to fly, and that you have the determination to help the team to win. So there are a couple of things that you had to do in order to be a successful base. You have to use everything you have, every ability that God has given you. You have to use your arms. You have to use your legs. You have to learn what perfect timing is all about. You have to be in sync with the others on the team. And you have to listen to the coach. It requires silence so that you can listen to the coach and to the spotter. And you have to stay alert and you have to be prepared at all times. If you are unable to do this, you will not be a successful base. So think about that in the church realm. So many times, especially we as the women in our churches, we are the base. Many times we are the ones who are helping others to fly. And then there's the spotter, who is none other than our leaders, our pastors, or even Christ himself, who is giving the directions. And all we have to do is follow them and use the skills that he has equipped us with so that everything can work together, so that we can be successful as a team. And we will be helping the body to be fitting perfectly together and working together in unison and in love. Remember, we all have the same base, right? We all have that same foundation, the one Lord, the one faith, the one baptism. But remember that it's the base that will determine the role that we're going to play and how everything is going to work together to accomplish the mission that we have been given. And finally, remember that the base equips us for exceptional results. He makes the whole body fit perfectly together. As each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts to grow so that we are those, the body is healthy and we are growing and full of love. So remember that the parts all have to fit together so that there is growth, maturity, love, and peace. Think about it. What would our churches be like, or even our convention, if it was all about the base? Thank you so much for joining me today. I pray that you may have received something from this that will help you to grow and have that exceptional strength and togetherness. God bless you. Thank you.
Seeing the future, and we cannot see through your cloud. We cannot see heartaches. Oh Lord, walk on my faith each day. Walk on my faith each day. Oh, on Monday, walk on. On Tuesday, walk on. Jesus, be your God. He is able, hello. You can see way down the road. Walk on by faith. Each day, walk on by faith. Each day, we cannot see the pitfall.
Please join us tonight at 7 p.m. for annual addresses by Mrs. Frankie M. Kirkendall, Women's Auxiliary President, Deacon Clifford Jones, Layman President, and Dr. Desmond C. Lamb, Minister's Council President. This has been a year of change, but our leaders have done all they can to encourage and support us. Let's show them our support. We will now have the benediction by Reverend James Brown, Assistant Pastor of Mount Carmel Baptist Church in Kansas City, Kansas. Thank you for joining us this afternoon.
The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And the people said, Amen.
This is Elizabeth Brown, your social media manager, coming to you with facts about breast cancer awareness. October is the Breast Cancer Awareness Month. And 1 in 8 women are diagnosed with breast cancer. And in some rare cases, men are diagnosed with breast cancer as well. Over 270,000 cases are considered invasive, and over 40,000 cases are considered non-invasive. In 2020, it has been projected that over 40,000 women with breast cancer will die in the U.S. So please get checked. Please go get your mammograms.
All right, so listen, welcome back. How are you loving the convention so far? I know I'm loving it because you know what? I love to hear the word of God because God wants to take us from glory to glory and faith to faith. And so I'm excited about this convention. And so now we've gotten into a time where we need your help. And yes, I know you know where I'm going with this. It's your opportunity to give back to this incredible convention. But before I just ask you for your money, I want to make sure that you could be a cheerful giver. Because, you know, there was once upon a time in my life that me and my money was so connected and there was no separation, right? But as I began to learn the word of God, I began to be more of a cheerful giver. And at this point right now, I love to give back to the Lord. And let me tell you why. You know, in Romans 13 and 8, the Bible says, owe no man nothing but to love him, right? You know that scripture. And so when you and I pour back into our local storehouses, when you and I pour into this convention, when you and I pour into taking care of the poor and the needy, you know what we're doing? We are actually investing into the kingdom of God. And if our resources, if our finances are going to go anywhere, why not go into the kingdom of God? But this is what I learned. You can't be God's giving. Say it with me. I can't be God's giving. Oh, you sound wonderful. So think about this. God said, owe no man nothing but to love him. So when I invest into the kingdom, when you invest into the kingdom, that literally obligates God to pour back into us. How do I know? Because in Malachi 3, 10 and 11, he said, if you bring your tithes to the storehouses, what did he say he would do? He said he would open up the windows of heaven and pour out blessings that you don't even have room to receive. He said he would rebuke the devourer for your sake. He says that the devourer won't even be able to destroy your fruit. Why? Because you can't outbeat God's giving. And then in Luke 6:38, he says, give. And after you give, what does he say? He says, give and you shall receive, pressed down, shaken together, running over. Men will pour into your bosom or pour into your lap. And so this is the time that we're asking you to invest into the work of the kingdom, invest into the work of the Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas. And so we have a couple of ways that you can do this. All right. First of all, you can use Cash App. I know that some of you are digital and that's all you do, but we got a way for you to give too. And so in Cash App, just go and locate KSWMU. I'll say it again, KSWMU, and you can donate any amount that the Lord lays on your heart. Givelify. Oh, yes, we're using Givelify. Just search Missionary Baptist State Convention of Kansas. And you know what? If you decide to do the snail mail, then go ahead and make your check or money order payable to MBSCK P.O. Box 4462, Kansas City, Kansas 66104. So let me encourage you to be a cheerful giver because guess what? You nor I can be God's giving. God bless you.
We'll be right back. Mm-hmm.